Okay, I don't know if people are going to move around a little bit, probably. That's totally fine. So I mostly want to leave it up to questions and discussions, if that's all right. But I did want to say a few things that I've learned, and we can talk about those, but we can also just talk about whatever you all want to talk about. First, I just want to talk a little bit more about what I've done at BYU, and if you're curious about any of those things, we can discuss that. And then also a few lessons I've learned. I've actually done a lot of different things at BYU. Like I said in my intro, I actually started not in FHSS. I first declared a public relations major, and then I switched to marketing. I actually did an internship in Asia for that. And I also did an internship with Simple Citizen, which is an immigration startup that helped immigrants do their paperwork for green card, citizenship, work visas, etc. And then I also got involved in Model United Nations. And like I said, that was the moment where I realized I wanted to switch paths. I realized that in discussing and understanding issues, it helped me see what solutions I could bring forward and how I could maybe have an impact on the world. And so I felt like the best place for me to do that was sociology. I had actually taken an intro to sociology class my very first semester, so I don't know what took me so long to realize that that's where I was supposed to be. But nevertheless, I was thankful for my experiences in other colleges. And I also got involved in international development. I was a TA for, I think, 5 semesters. I was president of the Students for International Development Club in 2017-18. I have also been very involved in the sociology department. I've done work with Ben and with Jane. With Ben, we did a randomized controlled trial with the Circles program. And with Jane, who's actually my advisor for my master's, she does a lot of work with immigration, which is what I'm focusing on. And if you're not in sociology, that's Ben Gibbs and Jane Lopez. They're amazing. You should take classes from them, talk to them, get involved somehow because they're amazing individuals. And then finally, more outside of BYU, I've been involved with Teens Act, which is a nonprofit that helps kids in Provo area graduate high school and go on to higher education. I started as a mentor, made my way to being associate director, and that has been a wonderful experience. And finally, I interned for the United Way of Salt Lake, doing data analysis with them. And I'm about to graduate, so we'll see what I do next. It's not definitive yet. I'm still in the search. But we can also talk about that because post-grad can be a little stressful. But I wanted to end by talking about a few lessons I've learned. And the first being to take advantage of opportunities at BYU. There is so much you can do, and it might seem daunting to get those opportunities, but it's okay to ask if you can be involved in something. You have to work really hard and just show what your skills are, and then professors or others will want to work with you. I used to think that I just was at the right place at the right time with opportunities I've had, but the reality, and that might be true a little bit, but I have found that I've also worked hard, and because of that, I've been able to work with different professors in different programs, etc. Another thing is that you don't have to have it all figured out. Like I said, I switched majors twice, so I definitely didn't have it all figured out from the beginning. And although you might want some sense of stability at some point in your college education, it's okay to explore like what your interests are. Things change a lot once you arrive in college, while you're in college, once you graduate, and so it's okay to not have it figured out. And finally, try to find some mentors because they're really going to change your life. And I cry about it at least once a month when I'm talking to my advisor, Jane, because I'm so thankful for her and other mentors I've had because they've helped me see that I can achieve a lot. professionally, personally, etc. And so I'm really thankful for that. But anyway, that's my whole quick summary. So I'm wondering if anyone has any questions or any comments on anything that we discussed already with everyone, or anything that I've said. And you can just unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, Claudia, I have a question. So I actually really liked when we were back in the main session, you kind of briefly mentioned like, don't apologize for succeeding as a woman, and also like, don't feel, I don't remember exactly how you said it, but like basically like, don't have imposter syndrome for like having goals or whatever. And I don't know, could you just like expand a little bit more about that? And also like how you've come to terms, like how you've learned that and how you've come to terms with that, because it's easier said, like, you know, in theory, I want to think that, but I still feel it all the time.
Definitely. Thanks for your question. So first, so I already mentioned that my mother worked my whole life. And so I was used to women working around me. My aunt also worked my whole life. And so it was important to have an example of a woman who was working and finding some sense of success in that. If that's what you want to do, you know, that's what I wanted to do. And so I wanted to find a mentor in that. I think if you want to work part-time, if you want to stay at home, which is also work, obviously, finding people, other women that you can see examples in is really important. Because you don't want to feel like you're the only one doing something. And sometimes it can feel that way. It can feel like you're the only one in your major, in your job, in your class, etc. And so it's important to find that. Another thing is you should not only say like, I want to work, because, and that's very empowering, but also set goals, I guess, of what you want to do. And because that's more concrete, then you can make plans to do that. And even if there are other things that, you know, other factors that affect that, like getting married or having children, et cetera, like you still have those goals and you can still work towards them. The plan might change, but you can still have those goals, and that's really important. And I know that a lot of people at BYU are married, so I will mention that I'm married as well, and that's something I've had to navigate. And my husband and I, we both have goals, and we have to learn to work on certain goals at certain times. For example, I started my master's first, and then he started his master's, and we're both going to graduate at about the same time. And, you know, there is pressure to, not from him, but from, I don't know, family, society, etc., to focus on his goals. But the reality is that both goals are important. And you don't have to apologize because you have goals. You don't have to apologize if you get an opportunity. You don't have to apologize if you get a good job and a good salary, because you deserve those things. You deserve anything that you set your mind to. And so what I mean by don't apologize is don't think you don't deserve those things. Don't think that you're only supposed to be doing one thing that people have told you to do. And with the imposter syndrome, it's difficult. You know, I still feel it often. But I just have to remind myself, like I said before, like I've worked hard to get to where I am. And I definitely don't know everything. But I know some things, and I deserve to be where I am. Anyway, so very long answer, but that's sort of what I reflected on when you asked me that question. So thank you. Does anyone else have a question or comment?
I do have a question, Claudia. You mentioned have similar paths as you, or are doing what you want to do. How did you find your own mentors?
Yeah, so like I said, I switched majors to sociology my junior year, actually, right before starting. And so I went into the program, you know, I hadn't had the first 2 years to sort of find mentors, but I knew sort of what my interests were. And so that's where I started. I knew I was interested in things such as social inequality. I knew I was interested in development. I knew I was interested in immigration. And so the first thing to do was take classes with professors that teach those things. And so, for example, Ben Gibbs, he teaches classes with inequality, teaches about social capital, et cetera. Scott Sanders, Scott teaches, you know, with things about development. And actually with Jane, it was interesting because she just started teaching around the same time as Haley Pierce. And I got an email that said, we have 3 new faculty. They're all women, which got me very excited. And I saw that one of them was focused on immigration and I couldn't believe it. And so I emailed her and said, hey, like when you get to town, like, can we meet and, you know, talk to her, and became a TA and then did research. I also went to Ben after I'd taken a few classes and asked if there was any research I could get involved in. And so, you know, it takes a few steps to find your mentors, but if you can figure out what do you want to work in, what areas you're interested in, and sort of take classes or join clubs or do research in those areas, that's really helpful. And there are people in FHSS that hopefully are doing what you're interested in, and you can reach out to them. You can look up classes and even take classes outside of FHSS. That'd be awesome too. And so there are professors out there that really want to help. I mean, Haley Pierce already mentioned that she has people come by her office, and professors really are like that. You can go knock on their door and pick their brain and ask for advice, and they're really willing. So I invite anyone that is looking for a mentor to do that. It can be intimidating, but professors are really nice and really willing to help. Michaela, for example, she's in the chat. She has definitely helped me figure out what I wanted to do with my master's. So thank you, Michaela. Any other questions or topics you want to discuss?
Yeah, I have a question. So what made you decide you talked about how you chose your major and now you like sociology, but what made you decide to get a master's degree in sociology as opposed to any other type of field?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's a very important question. So I personally, you know, did my bachelor's and I knew I wanted to be involved in things like immigration, the nonprofit sector. And I knew that it would really help to have a master's in order to just be, I guess, more qualified to be in those spheres. And at the same time, I was also considering a PhD. But as you know, or maybe not know, PhD takes a little longer, 4 to 7 years. Haley did hers in 3, so I don't know, that's amazing to me. But I didn't want to go straight into a PhD just yet because I wanted to figure out if I wanted to do more applied things or academic things. And so I decided to do the master's. And the reason I decided to do it at BYU, you know, do another degree at BYU, was because I had mentors that I could work with. And once you get into more of the advanced degrees, of course, like the topic of interest matters, but you really need to have a mentor and an advisor that you can work with. And so I knew that Ben and Jane could be people I worked with in my master's. And I knew that I could write a thesis and have them be, let's say, on my graduate committee to help me write about immigration and social inequality, which is what I'm doing. So the program is 2 years. And so that's something to keep in mind. You're going to be in school for another 2 years. But besides having to be in school for a little longer, it's such a good opportunity. It's shorter, but you gain a lot of expertise. You go from intaking knowledge to producing knowledge, which is really cool. And you get a lot more opportunities. I was able to teach a sociology class, and I was able to intern with a nonprofit, which is United Way. And actually, a lot of programs at BYU have really great funding, if you're concerned about that. And actually, the sociology program, and I'm sure other programs at FHSS, are very flexible. We have multiple people in the program who have had children while in the program or have gotten married. And so there's a lot of flexibility there. But anyway, long story short, I decided I wanted a little bit more education to then, you know, enter the workforce. So thanks for your question, Daniela. Any other questions or topics you want to discuss? Okay, well, I have a few things I could talk about because we only have like 5 minutes left. So one of the things that I thought about a lot is that, and I don't want to assume everyone here is LDS, so I'll acknowledge that, but being at BYU, you're at least around LDS culture, I could say pretty confidently. And so I wanted to talk about how there are cultural expectations for women, and that is something I've had to navigate myself, you know, in just being a woman that wants to work and being a woman who's married, etc. And so I just wanted to talk a little bit about that, because, you know, there is an expectation, or at least a large part of the female population stays at home, which I think is really wonderful. And, you know, children are very blessed by that. And so I would never ever want to discount that. I want to thank, you know, all women who stay at home, who work really at home taking care of their children and are not, I think, properly rewarded by society for it. But as a woman that wanted to work, I knew that there was certain cultural expectation to not do that, or at least focus more on the nurturing side of things. And what I've come to realize is that I can someday nurture my children. I don't have children yet. I'm pretty nurturing though. I really like to have snacks for everyone when I go on a road trip or on a trip, or make sure that everyone is prepared for things. But I realized that I can be nurturing and I can provide. And that's something that at first was difficult for me to, I guess, realize. But I know it's true that as a woman, I can do both. I know that I'm capable of doing both, and I need people in my life to support me in that. You know, I need family to support me in being someone who works, and then someday being a mother, hopefully. I need a husband who supports me in having goals and, you know, working towards them and achieving them. I need supervisors that see my potential and, you know, don't assume things about me simply because I'm a woman. And so I just wanted to talk a little bit about that. I don't know if any of you have felt that pressure to, you know, fit certain cultural expectations, but I definitely have. And I just want to say that there is a lot of good in, you know, being nurturing, but also a lot of good in providing. And I invite you to consider like what your role could be. And I'm here to tell you that you could do both. And it will take a lot of different shapes. It doesn't necessarily have to be, you know, a full-time job. You can work part-time, work from home, etc. But you will be doing both, it seems like. And so I think that's a wonderful thing. Let's see.
I have a question, Claudia.
Yeah. Hi, Faith.
Sometimes, and I don't know how much of it has to do with like some of the culture of the church or of Utah or the world, but sometimes it feels like there's only one way that life's allowed to look. And I just am curious to know if you've noticed that, or how you've sort of navigated it, or like had the courage or imagination to like accept the idea that life can look like a lot of different things.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Well, first of all, I didn't think I would be married during college. I actually didn't grow up being part of the LDS church. I converted when I was 18, so right before, like 6 months before I came to BYU. And so I didn't expect to be in Utah. I didn't expect to be married. I didn't really expect to still be here. I thought I would go back to Costa Rica right after I graduated. And so a lot of things have already changed. Change can be hard in your plans, but I've come to really embrace it because I accept that change can be hard, but I can also see the good in it. And I've been very blessed by coming to Utah, by getting married, by getting a master's, etc. So I've had to accept change even when sometimes we might not like it or want it. And I think the biggest thing is, because there will be change that's inevitable, something that can keep you, a little grounded is just asking yourself, like, what do I want to do? What, not thinking about everyone else, all the expectations, all the people, what do I want to do? What would make me feel fulfilled or passionate? How can I make an impact? And even that will take a lot of different forms, but in your life, as there are changes, if you can answer like yes to those questions, like, do I feel fulfilled? Do I feel passionate about this? Do I feel like I make an impact? If the answer is yes, I think even if things change, like you can still feel satisfied in those things. I think change happens. And I think another thing is you have to embrace like new paths that you might have not thought of. I never thought I would be, doing a master's in sociology, but I'm really grateful that I am. And that has opened a lot of other paths. And so now that I'm moving towards getting a job, I didn't think I would be working in the US. I thought I would go back. And so now I'm happy to find new paths in that. So, embrace the unknown, but also like set goals for yourself that keep you grounded and feel like you have a certain direction at least. Awesome. Okay. Actually, we ran out of time, so that was really fast. Thank you everyone for your questions. I know they're going to record this and record the other breakout room, so you should go listen to those because all the panelists are really awesome. And I don't know if, I don't think they gave our contact, but if you ever want to email me, I'm just going to write it on the chat really quick. Let's see. And you can email me about grad school, work, life, and I'm happy to chat with you, answer any questions you have. But thank you, everyone. This was awesome. Thanks for supporting this. I'm excited that this is a new focus for FHSS, and I just hope to see a lot of this in the future. But thank you. I hope you have a good day, and thanks for joining.